Hello, and thanks for tuning in to Jewels on Bell with Dr. Judith Fletcher, the show that is designed to provide you with the tools needed to live equipped, empowered, and inspired. Our goal is to help you live your best life. Joining us today is Ms. Kanae Corder. Welcome, Ms. Kanae.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
I'm going to share a little bit about your background, your professional experience, and what makes you the wonderful author, speaker, and coach that you are.
Okay, thank you.
Kanae Corder is the author of the book, The Art of Starting Over. Kanae is also the creator of several financial and work-life balance workshops. Kanae motivates attendees to take action for their financial and personal goals. She teaches them the tools to reduce stress associated with finances, techniques to heal from past mistakes, and give them resources to help them maintain financial peace. Kanae speaks to and consults with couples who would like to start off with a strong financial foundation or who are struggling to communicate over finances and would like to reduce the stress and arguments associated with money. Using her proven prosperity coaching system, Kanae talks to couples about going from being frustrated and hurt to being peaceful and healed. She also consults with divorcees and widowers who are struggling with the idea of making financial decisions. Kanae brings a wonderful listening ear and support to her clients who are going through resolving financial conflicts. Welcome, 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 Kanae.
Thank you.
It is such a pleasure to have you on our show. I've spoken with you on several occasions with our radio show.
Yes.
And it's always so informative and so empowering.
And energetic. We always have a good time.
Exactly. Yeah. First off, you know, from many of the conversations we've had, divorce, and finances are typically hand in hand.
Mm-hmm.
But what are, why is that?
Well, The number one reason for divorce is money.
Mm-hmm.
And when it's not number one, it's number two behind infidelity. And then there's financial infidelity, which is a whole nother subject. And, mm-hmm. and we talked about that before, and that's when you're keeping those secrets about money. But the reason why is because each person comes from a different background, and everybody has a different money mentality, and every money mentality doesn't go together.
Mm-hmm.
And so really you have to have some conversations really early on, maybe in your premarital counseling, that will help you understand what your partner's money mentality is, and the job of each person is to understand before being understood, and then once they understand their partner's money mentality, then to help them themselves grow in what their money mentality is. So if you can get on the same page, and you don't have to have the same money mentality, as long as you have complementary mentality, it can work.
And I realized that, well, I've been guilty of that, where it's true, we do have, oftentimes we have different relationships with money,
mm-hmm.
different
yes.
understanding of, you know, how the household should be ran financially. But I understand that is not just isolated situation where it's just this couple that's dealing with that.
Okay.
How common is that?
Yeah, it's very common. One of the last conversations that couples have is the money conversation. You know, you go out, you have fun, you know that you can have fun together, you know that you like to travel, you know that you both want children, but what your finances look like is one of the last questions, and mm-hmm. how you handle money is one of the last questions that they have before deciding to get married. And so because it's so at the last thing they talk about, mm-hmm. it's so important, even though it's so important, it is one of the last things. And because it's one of the last things, it's a really tough conversation that people mm-hmm. just keep putting off. If they can get to it earlier, mm-hmm. then they can work on it faster.
Okay. Yeah. Now, when it comes to handling money, who would you say should be the boss of the money, or the money manager of the household?
Well, a lot of times you'll hear me say the most conscientious person. And that does not necessarily mean the person who brings the money in. That one person could bring the money in and maybe the other person is just a lot better at managing the money or just has the time to do it. Mm-hmm. So it really needs to be a conversation between the couple. So as a financial advisor, I don't go out and tell my clients who handles the money as much as I say who would like to. Because sometimes there's a partner that doesn't want to have, they kind of want to be a little hands off. And it's important that they know what's going on. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't necessarily mean they have to, you know, click the button. Because nowadays, checks aren't getting
written anymore.
We're just like, click, send the money. So, you know, they don't have to necessarily send the money, but they at least need to know how the bills get paid and how much money comes in and goes out each month. And they need to have what I call a money day. So the couple sits down on their money day, not every day of the week, talking about money, or every time they see each other, shouldn't be a conversation about money. They just stick to their money day. And if that's Money Monday or Finance Friday, whatever day you want it to be, then you sit down and you have your money conversation, an hour, 2 hours, you know, somebody pays the bills, you say what, you know, this is what we need money for this week. Then you have those conversations and then you can enjoy your relationship.
Now, because you mentioned you meet someone, you go out on a date, everything sounds great. You know, all the likes, we love to travel, we love to shop. Mm-hmm. But what do you say to that individual, that couple, rather, not the individual, where they've come and they're at that point where you're no longer dating, you're trying to live life, but you're not living within that your income bracket.
Yeah. Well, that's tough. I mean, a lot of times that's keeping up with the Joneses. You know, that's really what it boils down to. It's us focusing on somebody else's life and saying we want it. So we go out and shop and spend. And, you know, I heard Deepak Chopra say that we spend money that we haven't even made to impress people we don't even know. And it's true.
Exactly.
So the first is managing your desires.
Okay.
That's number one. If we can manage our desires better, then we can get a handle on our money. And then once you manage your desires, the second thing is really figure out how much money you need to live the lifestyle that you deserve. And then work on getting that money, maybe even through having multiple streams of income.
And that's what I want to speak with you about. But before we get further into helping individuals that are trying to keep up with the Joneses,
okay,
let's take a quick break. And I want you to definitely share some tips to help save some of our viewers.
Absolutely.
And to our viewers, please don't touch that dial. We'll be right back. Hello, and thanks for tuning in to Jewels Unveiled with Dr. Judith Fletcher. As many of you know, those of you that have followed me over the years know that I had gone through a devastating divorce. And during that time, my whole foundation felt shaken. And there were so many changes that was taking place in my life till the point I actually had a nervous breakdown. And so I would like to share a few tips with those of you that are faced with some of the same challenges today. One, I encourage you to remain calm. Face the fact that this is what has happened. It's not the end of the world. The sun will shine. You will find joy again. Process what has happened. If you find that it's difficult for you to be alone during this difficult time, I encourage you to find support through family, friends, your local ministry, whether you have a church home or you're a member of an organization at which you volunteer at. Spend time with others. It is so important to find that support to keep you encouraged during this difficult time. Third, assess what changes need to be made for your life, what direction you would like to go in. The final step I would encourage you to take is take time. Do not rush into a new relationship. Use this time to heal. Use this time to really get over the hurt, the pain, as well as the loss of this relationship. And prepare for the next step of your life, the next phase of your life. And finally, I encourage you to remain confident in knowing that this too shall pass. Thank you. Welcome back to Jewels Unveiled with Dr. Judith Fletcher. And our guest today is Miss Kanae Corner. Welcome back, Kane.
Thank you.
Now back to keeping up with the Joneses.
Yes.
Help me save our viewers that are struggling with this issue.
So what you focus on expands. And maybe if I say this, this will help. What you focus on expands. So if you're focusing on what somebody else has, then they're going to get more blessings. So focus on your own and you'll get more blessings. And that sometimes means sacrifice. Now, that's a bad word. People don't always like to sacrifice, but I guarantee you, if you learn to sacrifice, you will never struggle. So just focus on yourself, know exactly what you need, know your why. Mm-hmm. Why am I doing this? Why do I want this? If you find that your why is because you're trying to keep up with somebody else or because they have it, then you can kind of stop yourself, correct yourself, and be a little convicted about that, and then make some correction. And say, you know what? I know what my why is. You can write it down. You can post it up as a family. You've heard me talk about having a family mission. And that helps a lot too. But I would say number one, manage your desires. Number two, know what you want. Focus on yours. And then number three, you know, just sacrifice.
And I know that the third one, the sacrifice, oftentimes people think that's probably one of the biggest and most challenging one.
Yes.
But, and I do understand that it has, if you don't make the necessary adjustments, that it can have an impact on other areas of your life.
Yeah.
And even with that, you're dealing with, exactly, the health. And then you're also having individuals that are trying so hard to keep up with the Joneses, they're charging everything.
Mm.
So, when it comes to managing their credit,
mm-hmm.
How could you improve your credit score if you're constantly spending more than
exactly.
you have? But then again, you have individuals that probably don't realize whether or not caring for their credit is even important. What do you say to that client?
Well, credit is one of my favorite conversations. It is one of the biggest misconceptions. Not many people know a lot about credit, which is one of the reasons why I like to talk about it so much. Number one is the moment your cards get over 40%, they're considered maxed out. So if you have, if your card actually is maxed out, then your credit score has gone down. If you can keep your credit cards at least at 30%, I really like for my clients to pay their credit cards off every month. Okay. But in the event you're not able to do that, say you use it for a big purchase, you at least want to have a plan as to how you're going to pay that off mm-hmm. before you use it again.
Okay.
So that's important too. Pay off your credit card before you use it again. That's a good rule of thumb. But never go over 30% because at 40%, over 40% is considered maxed out.
Okay. Yeah. So you mentioned paying off the credit card debt mm-hmm. if you can. Which is better? Because you have some people that are thinking, well, I want to improve my situation. I want to save.
Mm-hmm.
But then you have others where they may have attended a workshop that's telling them, oh, you know what? Pay off this credit card, pay this off and pay that off. Which is it?
Well, I would say any financial advisor worth his or her own, you know, weight and salt would not tell you to pay off debt without saving or investing. You have to find a combination between the two. And in some cases, you may have to multitask. Like, there are ways to save using your insurance policies and cash value in your insurance. There are creative ways to save. So you can't get away from saving just to pay off debt. Now, I know a lot of times people are stressed by the debt and it is costing them a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
But if you don't have a savings plan, when an emergency happens, you're going to end up using those cards again. And you're going to be right back where you started. So you have to find a combination. And that's something you sit down with your financial advisor. And a lot of people think you have to be a millionaire to have a financial advisor. You don't. Financial advice is important, and making decisions for yourself does not mean making decisions by yourself. So if you can find somebody who can take on your case, not every financial advisor will, but there are some out there who take, you know, customers or clients who have less than $1 million, you know, or, you know, some of the big guys, I understand they won't do that, but if there are financial advisors that will sit down with you and help you make a plan so that you can pay off your debt and save and invest at the same time.
And listening to how important it is to work with someone to get that support, because so many people out there are really trying, putting forth the effort. They decide it's the new year, I want to make a change. Yeah. And they're getting out there. What are some key things to look for when searching for a financial advisor to help them get their finances in order?
Well, a lot of it depends on your situation. So if you need credit restoration, then that's the first step that you need to take. Before you can go and begin talking to a financial advisor, get your credit in order, that's first. So okay. Working with a credit restoration specialist, that's one of the things that I do, but most financial advisors don't do that. Again, credit is one of those subjects that not everybody knows about. Mm-hmm. But that would be number one, get your credit in order. Number two is, as you get your credit in order and want to begin saving, as you start to pay down things, begin to take that money and put it into your savings account rather than spending it. Tax season, and a lot of times people take that tax return and go buy a new TV or a new couch or whatever. But you can take that tax return and begin your savings, or pay off the debt that's already on your credit. You know, so those are just a few of the tips that I give my clients. I'm not a big fan of tax returns, mm-hmm. But if you're going to get one, then at least do something positive.
Exactly. Right? Thank you so much, Kanae. Again, we need to take a quick break, but I have so many more questions for you. Thank you so much for, one, being a guest and sharing some wonderful tips.
Absolutely. And I can give them my website, so if they do need more tips, they can look on my website.
And how can they get more information?
Well, you can reach me at kineecorder.com. That's KineCorder.com. KineCorder.com.
Great. And to our viewers, please don't touch that dial. We'll be right back. Hello, and thanks for tuning in to Jewels Unveiled with Dr. Judith Fletcher. As many of you know, those of you that have followed me over the years know that I had gone through a devastating divorce. And during that time, my whole foundation felt shaken. And there were so many changes that was taking place in my life till the point I actually had a nervous breakdown. And so I would like to share a few tips with those of you that are faced with some of the same challenges today. One, I encourage you to remain calm. Face the fact that this is what has happened. It's not the end of the world. The sun will shine. You will find joy again. Process what has happened. If you find that it's difficult for you to be alone during this difficult time, I encourage you to find support through family, friends, your local ministry, whether you have a church home or you're a member of an organization at which you volunteer at. Spend time with others. It is so important to find that support to keep you encouraged during this difficult time. Third, assess what changes need to be made for your life. What direction you would like to go in. The final step I would encourage you to take is take time. Do not rush into a new relationship. Use this time to heal. Use this time to really get over the hurt, the pain, as well as the loss of this relationship. And prepare for the next step of your life, the next phase of your life. And finally, I encourage you to remain confident in knowing that this too shall pass. Thank you. Welcome back to Jewels Unveiled with Dr. Judith Fletcher. And our guest today is Ms. Kanae Corder, Ms. Prosperity Coach and Financial Advisor. Welcome back, yes. Kanae.
Thank you.
Now, we've covered keeping up with the Joneses.
Yes.
How do you work with someone who they've already damaged the credit, mm-hmm. But now it's beyond just working together as a couple. The relationship has failed. Mm-hmm. The marriage has ended. Everyone's going their separate ways. How can a person go from this point and to begin picking up the pieces to begin healing, not just emotionally but financially?
Absolutely. Well, one of the first things that I tell clients when they come to me is the marriage failed, you didn't. So you start out at the divorce is one of the lowest points in many people's lives. Mm-hmm. Now, there are some people who get divorced and they're like, see you, bye, you know, and they start all over and they just jump right back in, right? Mm-hmm. But for most people, it is one of the hardest points and the lowest points in their lives, and they feel like their whole life is shattered. So the first part is not even about the money. The first part is feeling, what are you feeling? What's going on mentally for you? And really helping a client understand, like I said, the marriage failed, they didn't. And if they can start over, you know, hence my book, The Art of Starting Over. And starting over is a process, and everybody can do it. Everybody is capable of it if you just give yourself the permission to say, yep, I'm going to do it. And then you make a commitment. And once you have that commitment, we start setting some goals. Mm-hmm. Now, we don't set the goals before we have those two things. You do have to just admit it, and you do have to commit to the changes that need to happen. And then once you have that, you set some goals. And once you set some short-term, mid-term, and long-term goals, you put some tasks in place to reach those goals. And one of the things that I have in every 10th chapter in the book, I have you celebrate or reward yourself. And I think a lot of times we work, and we forget to like pat ourselves on the back or, you know, relish over our accomplishments, even the small ones, you know?
Exactly.
Yeah, and in the book, I talk about my biggest accomplishment, which is not an award or an amount of money. It's just a small gesture I did for somebody. And because of how thankful they were, it is really my biggest accomplishment. No matter all of the things I've done, that's the one that I remember. That's the one that gets me up in the morning. That's the one when I'm down that I say, mm-hmm. you've done some things, you know, and exactly. and I'm thankful for, you know, the life that I've led.
And that's something that, as a divorcee, you do feel like, oh my goodness, everything has fallen apart. And you're right. Just that constant reminder that the marriage failed, you didn't. Mm-hmm. It's really important to remember that, to set goals and to begin rebuilding.
Yes.
And I thank you so much for sharing such wonderful tips with me, because like I told you, I've taken so many of the advice that you've given, because starting over after a divorce, it's not easy.
It's
and
not.
Oh my goodness, looking at your credit, and as you're splitting up financially and just so many different areas, mm-hmm. it does have a major impact. And it does eventually.
It does, but it's not the end. Believe it or not, there is no credit that can't be fixed. I know some people listening are like, what?
Wondering, like,
no, you have not
seen my credit. Exactly.
There is no credit that can't be fixed. Mm-hmm. As long as you're willing to stop doing what you did. Because if you keep doing what you did, you're going to keep getting what you've gotten. So you have to stop. That's first. You make those sacrifices that I talked about. But there's no credit that can't be fixed. If you're willing, if you're committed, I can show you how to fix your credit. There's no place that you can't get out of. But it's just going to take some sacrifice, some diligence, and some accountability.
So we were speaking about, you know, the benefits of recovering after divorce and getting your credit and everything together, mm-hmm. And even moving beyond that, I understand you have a Prosperity Club.
Oh yes, the Prosperity Club. It's a free club. It's like a community of people who have dedicated themselves to maintaining, restoring, or just gaining financial peace, you know, and the great thing about it is you get tips, you get tools. Most of the time I'll just give out stuff. I give away a lot of free stuff. Mm-hmm. And then also there are other, you know, that you're not alone. There are other people who have been through what you've been through, whether it is recovering after divorce or whether it's, just learning, understanding, because I'm not assuming that everybody who's in the Prosperity Club is a bad steward of their money. Mm-hmm. But nor am I assuming that everybody in the Prosperity Club is a good steward of their money. But what I am assuming is that everybody can use a little bit more information. You know, everybody can use an accountability partner or just somebody to listen. And so that's what the Prosperity Club is. You get to ask questions that you normally wouldn't get the answers to. You know, a lot of times, aside from keeping up with the Joneses, we try to pretend like we know everything.
Exactly. And so we don't have any problem. We're not drowning in our finances.
Exactly. So if you can just talk about it, because, you know, money is this taboo subject and it shouldn't be. We should be able to talk about it. So if you could just talk about it a little more, you can learn from it. Okay. You can correct mistakes and misconceptions and you can heal financially.
And what would you say is the probably absolute number one New Year's resolution that people should focus on?
Yeah, I'm not a huge fan of resolutions. I like, you can't resolve to being different. You have to evolve. And so in order to, and to have that evolution in your life, it's a lifestyle change. Okay. And some of that is what we talked about earlier, managing your desires, being able to, you know, be comfortable in some sacrifice, you know, just not going out spending every dollar you make, because it's not what you make, it's what you keep. And so, and really having a strategy around making sure that your finances are taken care of, know what's coming in and what's going out. So there's just a few tips. It's really not difficult to have financial peace, but the number one way to do it is to know who you are and what's important to you.
Okay. Thank you so much, Kanae. You have been an amazing guest as usual.
Thank you.
And for our viewers that would like to learn more about the Prosperity Club, as well as maybe receiving some free tips on how to get their finances in order and recover even financially from a divorce, where can they reach you?
Okay, they can go to kineecorder.com. That's kineecorder.com. And click on sign up and you'll be able to put in your information and join the Prosperity Club. You'll get an email and welcoming you and tips every month.
Great. Thanks again so much for being a wonderful guest. And to our viewers, please tune in again to learn more information on how to live equipped, empowered, and inspired. Thanks. Hello, and thanks for tuning in to Jewels Unveiled with Dr. Judith Fletcher. As many of you know, those of you that have followed me over the years, know that I had gone through a devastating divorce. And during that time, my whole foundation felt shaken. And there were so many changes that was taking place in my life till the point I actually had a nervous breakdown. And so I would like to share a few tips with those of you that are faced with some of the same challenges today. One, I encourage you to remain calm. Face the fact that this is what has happened. It's not the end of the world. The sun will shine. You will find joy again. Process what has happened. If you find that it's difficult for you to be alone during this difficult time, I encourage you to find support through family, friends, your local ministry, whether you have a church home or you're a member of an organization at which you volunteer at. Spend time with others. It is so important to find that support to keep you encouraged during this difficult time. Third, assess what changes need to be made for your life, what direction you would like to go in. The final step I would encourage you to take is take time. Do not rush into a new relationship. Use this time to heal. Use this time to really get over the hurt, the pain, as well as the loss of this relationship, and prepare for the next step of your life, the next phase of your life. And finally, I encourage you to remain confident in knowing that this too shall pass. Thank you.